Good morning, and welcome to this, our celebration of the Holy Mass for Palm Sunday. I'm Monsignor Michael Champ, pastor and bishop of the Old Catholic Church in Tucson. Welcome. Let us begin with our opening hymn, Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring.
Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring, Holy Wisdom, Love most bright, drawn by you, our souls aspiring, soar to uncreated light. Word of God, our flesh that fashioned, with the fire of life impassioned, striving still to truth unknown, soaring, dying round your throne. Through the way where hope is guiding, hear what peaceful music rings. Where the flocks in you confiding drink of joy from deathless springs. Theirs is beauty's fairest pleasure, theirs is wisdom's holiest treasure. You do ever lead your own in the love of joys unknown.
Our entrance edify this morning comes to us from Psalm 24. Open wide the doors and gates, lift high the ancient portals. The King of Glory enters. Who is this King of Glory? He is God, the mighty Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you who have come to us, so rich in love and mercy. Hosanna in the highest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us begin as we always do, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray today as we accompany our King to Jerusalem. Almighty Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you sent your Son to be born of woman and to die on a cross, so that through the obedience of one man, estrangement might be dissolved for all men. Guide our minds by his truth and strengthen our lives by the example of his death, which we may live in union with you in the kingdom of your promise. Grant this through Christ our Lord. My dear friends, for 5 weeks of Lent, we have been preparing by works of charity and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery. Today, as we come together to begin our solemn celebration in union with the whole church throughout the world, Christ entered in triumph into his own city to complete his work as our Messiah, to suffer, die, and rise again. 6 days before the solemn Passover, the Lord came to Jerusalem, and children, waving palm branches, ran out to welcome him. They loudly praised the Lord, saying, "Blessed are you who have come to us, so rich in love and mercy." United with him in his suffering on the cross, may we share his resurrection and new life. We pray, Almighty God, we pray and bless the branches that make them holy. Today we joyfully acclaim Jesus, our Messiah and King. May we reach one day the happiness of the new and everlasting Jerusalem, by faithfully following him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Hosanna to the King of David, the King of Israel. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
In order to celebrate our sacred mystery today, let us call forth our own sins and be repentant of them. Lord Jesus Christ, you have given us the ultimate sacrifice of your life for our sins. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you came into Jerusalem riding in triumph, only to be crucified 6 days later. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are our beacon, our leader, our King. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God forgive you your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now turn to the liturgy of the word. Our first reading is taken from the Old Testament book of Isaiah, from the third servant song of Yahweh. As mentioned at the feast of baptism of the Lord, it is not clear whom the inspired writer had in mind when he composed the four songs describing the ideal servant or son of God. He may be a collective person, Israel, God's people, or he may be a king of the past, or the Messiah, anointed king to come. In any case, Christians applied these hymns very early to Jesus, and they are used throughout Holy Week as a beautiful commentary of the Passion narratives. Hear now these words from Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning he opens my ear that I might hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our responsorial psalm is from Psalm 22.
My God, why have you abandoned me?
Join me.
My God, why have you abandoned me? All who see me scoff at me, they mock me with parted lips. They wag their heads. He relied on the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he loves him. My God, why have you abandoned me? Indeed, many dogs surround me. A pack of evildoers closes in upon me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. My God, why have you abandoned me? They divide my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. But you, O Lord, be not far from me. O my help, hasten to aid me. My God, why have you abandoned me? I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All your descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. My God, why have you abandoned me?
The text of our second reading is actually a Christ hymn sung in the early church, which beautifully describes our Blessed Lord's utmost humiliation that he suffered on the cross. But by being obedient, he made up for our sinful disobedience. But this hymn also sings of Christ's exaltation by the Father. Listen now to Paul's words to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking on the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, let us prepare now for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Join me.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name which is above every other name. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Lord, be in my heart and on my lips, and I worthy proclaim your holy word. The Lord be with you. A reading of the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What are you willing to give me if I hand him over?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on, he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'" The disciples then did as he bid them. When it was evening, he reclined at table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, "Amen, I say to you, one of you will destroy me." Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him one after another, "Surely it is not I, Lord." He said in reply, "He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for him had he never been born." Then Judas, the betrayer, said in reply, "Surely it is not I, Rabbi." He answered, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and given it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father." Then after a singing of hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them, "This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, shall go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him in reply, "Though all of us all have their faith shaken, mine will never be." Jesus said to him, "Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." Peter said to him, "Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you." And all the apostles spoke likewise. Then Jesus came to them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them, "My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me." He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to them, "Peter, so you could not keep watch with me for only an hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again, "My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done." Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying, "This man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him." Immediately he went over to Jesus and said, "Hail, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus answered him, "Friend, do what you have come for." Then stepping forward, they laid hands on him and arrested him. And behold, one of those who had accompanied Jesus put his hand to the sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass that the writing of the prophets may be fulfilled." Then all disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance as far as the high priest's courtyard, and going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Finally, two came forward who stated, "This man said, 'I can destroy the temple of God and within 3 days build it again.'" The high priest rose and addressed him, "Have you no answer? What are these men saying against you?" But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said, "I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Messiah, the Son of God." In reply, Jesus said, "You have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his robes and said, "He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witnesses? What is your opinion?" They said in reply, "He deserves to die." They spat on his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy for us, Christ. Who is it that struck you?" Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over and said, "You too were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it in front of everyone, saying, "I do not know what you are talking about." As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, "This man was with Jesus the Nazarene." Again he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." A little later, bystanders came over and said to Peter, "Surely you too were one of them. Even your speech gives you away." At that he began to curse and swear, "I do not know the man." Immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and wept bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver, departed, and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, saying, "It is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the price of blood." After consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial ground for foreigners. That is why that field even today is called Blood Field. Then it was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by some of the Israelites. They paid it out for some potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded them. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and he questioned him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." And when he was accused, the chief priests and the elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said, "Do you not know how many things they are testifying against you?" But he did not answer one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. When they assembled, Jesus said, "Which one do you want me to release to you? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus called the Messiah?" For he knew that it was out of envy they had handed him over. While he was still seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message. The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply, "Which of the two do you want me to release?" They answered, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus called the Messiah?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." But he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" They only shouted the louder, "Let him be crucified." When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all and that a riot was breaking out, he took water and washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves." And the whole people said in reply, "His blood be upon us and on our children." And he scourged Jesus and handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped his clothes and threw a military cloak about him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head, put a reed into his right hand, and kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. When they had mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to be crucified. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon, that they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. Then they placed over his head the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads, saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself, if you are the Son of God, and come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests and the scribes and elders mocked him and said, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. So he is King of the Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. About 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of the bystanders heard it and said, "This one is calling for Elijah." Immediately one of them ran to get a sponge, soaking it with wine and putting it on a reed. He gave it to him as a drink. But the rest said, "Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him." But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. Some of the bystanders who heard it said, "Behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the men with him who were keeping watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening, and they said, 'Truly, this was the Son of God.' There were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother and the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea called Joseph, who himself was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in clean linen and laid it in a new tomb that he had hewn from the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance to the tomb and departed. And Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained seated there, facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember that this impostor, while still alive, said, 'After 3 days I will be raised up. Give orders then that the grave be secured until the third day, lest his disciples come and steal him and say to the people, he has been raised from the dead. This last imposture would be worse than the first.' Pilate said to him, 'The guard is yours. Go secure it as best you can.' So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to the stone and setting the guard." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Well, let's join together now and profess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Begotten, not made, one in being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. May the mystery of the mingling of this water and wine help us to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Lord God, we ask you to receive us and be pleased with the sacrifice we offer you with humble and contrite hearts. I will wash my hands among the innocent and encompass your altar, O Lord, that I might hear the voice of your praise and tell of all your wondrous works. I have loved, O Lord, the beauty of your house, the place where your glory dwells. Take not away my soul, O God, with the wicked, nor my life with man in heaven, with men of blood, in whose hands are iniquities and filled with gifts. But as for me, I have walked in my innocence. Redeem me and have mercy on me. In the churches I will bless you, O Lord. Lord, wash away my iniquities and cleanse me of my guilt. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and that of all his church. Dear Lord, may the suffering and death of Jesus, your only Son, make us pleasing to you. Alone we can do nothing, but may this perfect sacrifice win us your mercy and love. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well and always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Though he was sinless, he suffered willingly for sinners. Though innocent, he accepted death to save the guilty. By his dying, he has destroyed our sins. By his rising, he has raised us up to the holiness of life. We praise you, Lord, with all the angels in their song of joy. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power, God of might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Father, you are holy indeed. All your creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the working of the Holy Spirit, from age to age, you gather a people to yourself, so that from east to west, a perfect offering may be made to the glory of your name. And so, Father, we bring you these gifts. We ask you to make them holy by the power of by the power of your Holy Spirit, that they may become one body and one blood in your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Holy Eucharist. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread into his sacred hands, and looking up to you as Heavenly Father, he gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, he took the cup filled with wine. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, gave the cup to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Father, calling to mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven, and ready to greet him again when he comes, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Lord, look with favor on your church's offering and see the victim whose death has reconciled us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by his body and blood may be filled with his Holy Spirit and become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make us an everlasting gift to you and enable us to share in the inheritance of your saints, with Mary, Virgin Mother of God, and your apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, on whose constant intercession we rely for help. Lord, may this sacrifice, which has made our peace with you, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Strengthen in faith and love your pilgrim church on earth, along with your patriarchs and leaders. Bernd, our patriarch in Utrecht, Francis, Bishop of Rome, and for me, your humble servant, and all bishops and clergy, with the entire people, your son has gathered for you. Father, hear the prayers of the family you have gathered before you. In mercy and love, unite all your children wherever they may be. Welcome into your kingdom our departed brothers and sisters and all who have left this world in your friendship. We hope to enjoy forever the vision of your glory through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Let us join together now and pray to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin and sheltered from all needless anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I give you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but the faith of our church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with us always.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
May the mystery of the mingling of this bread of our Lord's body and blood bring eternal life to all who receive it. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi custodiat anima meam in vitam aeternam. Amen. Sanguis Domini nostri Jesu Christi custodiat anima meam in vitam aeternam. Amen.
And this is love, not that
Father, if this cup may not pass, but I must drink it, then your will be done. Let us pray. Lord, you have satisfied our hunger with this Eucharistic food. The death of your Son gives us hope and strengthens our faith. May his resurrection give us perseverance and lead us to salvation. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Bow your heads now and pray for God's blessing. The Father of mercies has given us an example of unselfish love by the sufferings of his only Son. Through your service of God and neighbor, may you receive his countless blessings. And may Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Eucharistic celebration is ended for today. Let us go forth from this place to serve the Lord and one another. Thanks be to God. Our closing hymn today, The Church's One Foundation.
The Church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the Word. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore. Till with the vision glorious, her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest.
God love you all, and thank you for being with us today.